Hello students, again remaining part of the special sense of the eye. Today we are going to discuss about the pathway of the light reflex. As we receive information from the light, that goes to the optic nerve, then it goes to the optic tract, superior colliculi of the both sides, that is the pretectal nucleus, and then via the colliconuclear fibers to the third nerve, that is Edinger-Westphal nucleus, then to the ciliary ganglia via short ciliary nerve, then to the sphincter papillae. This is the pathway of the light reflex. This is the optic pathway. First, it is from the these are the ganglion cells, from there to the optic nerve. This is the optic nerve and this is the optic chiasma, where fibers from the in right eye, fibers on the medial side cross the optic chiasma on the opposite side, and from the right side, medial side, this crosses to the opposite side. From optic chiasma, that is the pretectal region, this goes to the optic tract, fibers from the, if we consider that from the right eye, that goes to the lateral side, goes to the same side, and medial side crosses the fiber. This means it has got fibers from the right side of the lateral side and medial side of the left eye. Then it goes to the lateral geniculate body, and through the genitocalculon tract it goes to the optical cortex, which is the where visual which is the visual cortex. Now optic nerve, when there is lesion to the optic nerve, this is the A proximal part of the optic nerve, there is ipsilateral blindness on the affected side. There is ipsilateral, if it is cut over here, there is damage over here, there is ipsilateral, that is left side will be damaged, means ipsilateral damage on the affected side, and absence of right reflex on the ipsilateral side and consensual on the contralateral side. This is near reflex present. Then if it is at the optic chiasma in the pretectal region, if lesion is there, there is this is called central chiasmatic lesion. There will be bitemporal, this is on the temporal side, there will be bitemporal hemiapnea. This is hemiapnea, means half side of the vision. In the right side, there will be lateral side of both the eyes will be temporal, that is bitemporal hemiapnea, the lateral side will be not included. If there is causes for this lesion can be pituitary tumors or craniopharyngioma or supracellular aneurysm. Then if it is at the optic chiasma, there will be binasal hemiopnea. If it is at the optic chiasma, there will be, this is the lesion, that will be lateral chiasmatic lesion, and there will be binasal hemiopnea. Binasal hemiopnea, paralysis of the pupillary reflex, and this also leads to the partial descending optic atrophy. Cause for this can be due to the internal carotid aneurysm or lesions causing distension of the third ventricle. Now if it is at the optic tract, this is as the optic tract, then there will be oncongruous homonymous hemianopia. that is on left side medial side is paralyzed, on right side lateral side is paralyzed. This is called contralateral hemioptysis if it is at the level of the optic tract. Causes for this can be syphilitic meningitis, tuberculosis or tumors of the optic chiasma. If there are tumors over here in the optic chiasma, then there will be contralateral hemioptysis. Now, if it is at the lateral geniculate body, there will be incongruous hemioptysis, that is sparing the right reflex and pupillary reflex. Light reflex here, if it was cut here, pupillary reflex was hindered. But if it is at the lateral geniculate body, pupillary reflex and light reflex will be present. And there is partial descending optic atrophy. Last is if it is at the genico-calcarine tract, there will be hemioptysis on the homonymous hemioptysis, and this is covering the blind spot of that area. Now this is the lateral geniculate body, its ventral parts, and this is the dorsal part. Parvocellular pathway goes from the primary visual cortex. This sends information to the primary visual cortex, that is visual cortex area number 17. This you can see, this is the calcarine fissure, upper part, lower part, that is that gets information from the peripheral retina, and these green part and blue part, that this gets information from the macula, that is the calcarine. This one, the is the calcarine fissure that differentiates both the two. And there is frontal area eye field that is covered by the area 8. Area 17 is primary visual area that gives information. You can see this goes to the information to the visual cortex area 17. This is the 17 area, visual area. Then area 18, that is the visual psychic area. Area 19, that is for the occipital eye field. So we conclude that frontal eye field is by the area 8 and occipital eye field by the area 19. Now aqueous humor formation, this is the magnification of this area. Aqueous humor, already we have discussed, aqueous humor is regularly formed after every 4 hours replaced, and fluid is formed here by the ciliary body and enters the anterior chamber, and fluid exits from this area. Now aqueous outflow system, it includes trabecular meshwork, Schlamm's gland and collector channels, aqueous veins, episcleral veins. Aqueous humor is relatively cell-free and protein-free. This fluid is formed by non-pigmented ciliary epithelium, slightly hypertonic. It is acidic, that is pH is 7.2. And there is marked excess of the ascorbate, marked deficit of the proteins, and there is slight excess of the chloride and lactic acid. Chloride and lactic acid are more in this. Now, what are the physiochemical properties of this? Volume is 0.31 ml, that is in the anterior chamber, that is 0.25 ml in the anterior chamber, and 0.06 ml is in the posterior chamber. Now refractive index, that is 1.336, slightly lower than that of the cornea, and slight divergence of light as it passes past cornea and aqueous interferences there. Density is slightly greater than that of the water. Osmotic pressure is there. Aqueous is slightly hyperosmotic to plasma by 3 to 5 milliosmoles per liter. It is acidic, that is 7.2. Rate of formation is 2.3 milliliter per minute. Formation aqueous humor, that is by the ciliary process, are the site of the aqueous production. The various constituents of the aqueous humor have to pass 3 layers of the ciliary process, that is capillary wall, stroma, and 2 layers of the epithelium. Formation process that involves diffusion, ultra diffusion, and excretion. Diffusion is by 10%, ultrafiltration is 20%, excretion is 70%. Diffusion is that is lipid soluble substances are transported through the lipid proteins portions of the cell membrane, proportional to a concentration gradient across the membrane. Ultrafiltration, that is water and water soluble substances. That ultrafiltration is by water and water soluble substances, and this ultrafiltration is limited by size, charge, and flow through the theoretical micropores in the cell membrane, and in response to an osmotic gradient by the hydrostatic pressure, which is influenced by intraocular pressure, blood pressure in the ciliary capillary, and plasma osmotic pressure. This osmotic gradient is there, and this is influenced by intraocular pressure, blood pressure in the ciliary capillaries, and plasma osmotic pressure. Diffusion and ultra-diffusion are both passive mechanisms, with lipid and water-soluble substances from the capillary core traversing the stroma and passing between the pigmented epithelial cells, and it is limited by the tight junction of the non-pigmented epithelial cells. There is active transport, that is of the aqueous, that is for the water-soluble substances. Now, excretion active transport, that is water-soluble substances of larger size or greater charge, are actively transported across the cell membrane, require the expenditure of the energy. And that energy is supplied by sodium-potassium ATPase and glycolytic enzymes, which are present in the non-pigmented epithelial cells. Active transport is decreased by hypoxia, hypothermia, and any inhibitor of the active metabolism. Active transport accounts for the majority of the aqueous production, and that is mediated by the lobular proteins in the membrane. Now, how aqueous is formed? First is in the stromal pool, then active transport of this into the stromal filters, then passive transport across the pigmented ciliary epithelium. Then substance pass the capillaries of the ciliary process, then across the stroma behind the tight junction of the non-pigmented epithelium. The tight junction between the non-pigmented epithelium cells create part of the blood aqueous barrier. Substances that are actively transmitted are sodium chloride, potassium, ascorbic acid, amino acid, and bicarbonate. Control of aqueous formation, that is, it is by the adrenergic innervation. Ciliary epithelium doesn't show nerve supply, but vessels have nerve supply. Majority of the receptors in ciliary body are A2 and B2 receptors. Stimulation of A2 receptors lower the aqueous humor production through the inhibition of the adenyl cyclase. It means A2 receptor inhibit the adenyl cyclase and lower the formation of the aqueous humor. Stimulation of P2 receptors leads to increase in the production of the stimulation of the adenyl cyclase, and it will release more of the aqueous homework. That's all for today. Thank you.